Hey, World Harvest Family Church, thank you for joining us this morning. We're really excited to be coming into your living room, and we've got a great service plan, so enjoy.
Hey, good morning or good afternoon, whatever time it is that you're watching this. Thanks for joining us, and today's going to be quite different, I guarantee you. And I'm going to encourage you to stay on from beginning to end. I'm also going to ask you that, man, if you're following us, push that like button and also push that share button. This is one way that we can reach more people. If you would just help us and be a part of what we're doing here and trying to cast out vision and impart vision and hope into others, push that share button and stay tuned to this whole service, this whole program. I want to read a scripture to you really quick. It's out of Romans chapter 8, verse 28. It says this. It says, "And we know that all things work together for good, for those that love God, to those that are called according to His purpose." I'll read it one more time. "And we know that all things, God works for our good, to those that love Him and are called according to His purpose." This morning I've got three questions for you. Very simple. One, do you believe in God? Two, do you believe in His Word? Three, here's the real one that I really want to answer today and deal with. Do you believe that when this is all said and done, this situation that we're in right now, do you believe that when it's all said and done, we can come out on the other side better and stronger than just coming out, just barely surviving? I think question number one, most everybody's going to say, yeah, I believe in God. You know, check mark. Question number two, do you believe in His Word that it's true? And most everybody's going to say, yeah, I believe in that. Then question number three, I think that may be a little bit more difficult to answer, to be honest with it in answering. I think most of us will say, yeah, I believe, because we believe God can do anything. But I'm not asking you, do you believe God can do it? I'm asking, do you believe you can come out on the other side better? Not just wait this thing out, not just barely survive, and then once we get to the other side, we pick up where we left off and continue with life. I'm saying that when this is all said and done, and when doors are open again, and we go out, we're better because these last two, 3 months, we've actually grown, we've actually learned, we've actually been strengthened, and we're better off. That's what I'm trying to get at this morning. And if you said you believe in God, and you said you believe in your Word, I just read you a verse, friends, that said that God is able to make all things turn out for good. Any situation, even a bad one, God can turn it around for good. This is what we would call a bad situation. There's a lot of bad stuff happening out there. But I'm convinced, because I know God, and because I know He's true to His Word, that He can turn this situation out for better. In other words, for me, when this is all said and done, for me and my household, will be better and stronger. I'll give you a little example. You know, one of my daughters right now, she's got a loose tooth. And last night, I told her, or her mom told her, hey, we're going to have to take care of that. And she didn't want to, because the first thing she thinks of is it's going to hurt. And I asked her, I said, when have I ever pulled out a tooth from you or one of your sisters and it actually hurt? And she and her sister said, well, it's never hurt. You know, she's dealing with a little bit of a bad situation. What's the bad in it? It's interfering. It's dangling. Every once in a while, she has to rinse her mouth because there's a little bit of blood in there. It's just inconvenient. It's not a good situation. It's a little bit bad. But if she were to let me get involved and let me take care of that, although she thinks it may hurt, it's not going to hurt her. In fact, if anything, I'm going to help her. And when I'm done pulling it out, then we can begin this new process, this new season of another tooth coming out. And that tooth that's coming out is going to be better and stronger and permanent. It's a bad situation that if she just lets me get involved, Dad will take care of it. Listen, Dad will take care of it, and the end result is going to be good. We're talking about Romans 8:28 today, and we're talking about a bad situation that if we give it to Dad, the Bible says He's our Dad, He's our Abba Father. If we give it to the Father, God can turn it around for our good, that we just didn't merely survive, but we came out stronger and better. And that's what I want to deal with today. Question number three, I want to encourage you, and I want to challenge you, and I want you to get you to believe, get that in your mind frame, that we can go through this, but in the process, build some spiritual muscles and get on the other side. And when we are on the other side, hey, we're stronger, we're better. And I'm going to do something very different. We're about to step out. We're about to get in my vehicle. And I'm going to take you to some places that were hard situations in my life. That were tough situations. But because I love God, and because I'm called according to His purpose, and you're called according to His purpose, I took this bad situation and I looked at my father and I looked at his promise, and I took that broken toy, those broken pieces, and I put them in his hand, and I held on to his hand, and when he gave it back to me, he gave it back to me better. Not just fixed, but better. And in the process of trusting him, of walking with him, I grew and I'm stronger. Those bad situations turn into good. So I'm telling you, today's going to be really, really different. And you're going to come on a ride with me. You're going to come on a journey with me. And I'm going to share my heart, and I hope that you'll be encouraged, and I hope that you'll be strengthened this morning, that God can turn all things for our good. Amen. Come on with me. All right. Thanks for joining me on this little drive. We're going to stay in the vehicle, so don't worry. We're going to follow all kinds of guidelines. No, we're not going to interact with other people. We're in a tiny community called Ed Couch El. So this is kind of where I grew up. This was my old stomping grounds. And so a big part of my heart, my life is in this place. I don't come back over here very often. Only kind of when I've come visit my parents and stuff like that. But in the community, I'm not as involved as I'd like to be. But this is a special place. A lot of great people live here. Great people. A lot of talented people. Just a tight-knit community. And this is where I went to school. Actually, I grew up about, I'd say about a couple minutes west of here, which where I grew up, a tinier community called La Blanca. And I was actually supposed to be going to school in Edinburgh. We were zoned to Edinburgh School District, but my mom worked at a school here, still does. Been faithful part of the school district here for 40 plus years. So because she worked here, we could come to school here. And just did it from pre-K all the way till I graduated. But yeah, this place is huge in my heart. It's part of who I've become. Right over here, that is now a technology center, but for me that was the central gym. The other day the girls and I were in this area, and I pointed to that building. I said, I used to be a gym. I spent hours upon hours in that gym. We're getting ready to pull up into the high school here, and a lot of these buildings are new. They weren't around when we were here. This has kind of been maybe the last 10 years or so. So a lot of these buildings I haven't been in. Well, I think this one, I came and spoke to the senior class about 7 or 8 years ago, one of these buildings. Now there over there is a brand new gym. Very nice gym. I've been in it. I haven't played in it, but they got a beautiful floor, beautiful facility. Got big screen TVs, nothing like when I was in here. But I don't want to show you that building. I want to show you what I knew to be my high school. And this is it right here. We're getting on, and not this one. This one over here. It's an older building. But I spent 4 years of my life here, and four very important years that kind of shaped who I am today. And I'll get to show you around the building. I can show you the entrance. I can show you more of it, but I'll show you what, to me, when I think of high school, I'll show you what I think of, what meant the most to me. Gotta drive around the back to get to it. And I remember parking vehicles here and going in there. I had a locker, one of those hallways there. Few classes there. That right there used to be the library. I don't know if it's the library anymore, but I went in there once or twice. That was about it. Didn't care too much about the library. This over here is where this one here is special to me. This is, when I think of high school, this is what I think of. Now it's an older gym. Now it's become a practice gym. I spent a lot of hours in there, working hard and dreaming big and in fact, up there when I still go in there, haven't been in a couple years, but when I go in there, like to look at the banners up there. There's still banners of the days that me and my teammates, or my classmates, man, had great friends, great teammates, built a lot of memories. I still see those banners up there. You know, one of the neat things about this gym is that I actually got to coach in there too. Back in 2009 and 2010, brought a team out to and we played a tournament here. And then a couple years back, I'd say about 4 years ago, I brought another team. So that's pretty cool. I got to watch my kids, my students, play in the same court that I played on. And that, this gym here is called Robert Capello. You know, my coach for all those years, man, I just a tremendous, a legend in my book, in my eyes, in my life. And the reason why I bring you out here was because this is all I knew. This was what drove me back then. You know, I could have showed you the rest of the school, but to me, it's like, this is where my heart was. And I was 17 years old when depression wasn't, you know, as popular or as common as it is now. You know, I was facing a few, you know, I guess that's what it was. I just navigated my way through it, just keep going. But anyway, it was at about 17, 18 years old, my junior, senior year, where I had said yes to Jesus a couple of years back at a small Baptist church around here. My aunt Linda, if you're watching, hi Thea. She's the one that invited me to that church, and that's where I said yes to Jesus. But, you know, I didn't live for him, didn't know how. And a couple of years later, I got to a point in my life, man, where just things were closing. It felt like things were closing in. And I didn't know what to do. It's, like I said, forms of types of depression and then fear. I remember dealing with a lot of fear. Not afraid for my own life, but afraid for the people I love the most. I mean, what if tomorrow, you know, what if I lose someone? That kind of fear. I didn't have much peace. And I remember at night, you know, just a lot of times just staying up, couldn't go to sleep. It was the absence of peace was evident in my life. So all that kind of came falling down on me around that time, and nobody knew it. You know, I stayed busy with playing ball and doing my own thing that, for the most part, I was doing all right. But it was that year that I said, the enemy was, I guess, he was pouncing on me. But at the same time, God was trying to draw, and it was like a tug of war. You know, God's wanting to do something great in my life, and Satan's not wanting to let go. I mean, that's the only thing I can chalk it up to. And at that point, I remember calling out to God and saying, you know what, my life is yours. I didn't want to do it. Honestly, I didn't want to give God 100% of my life because I didn't want to believe. I didn't want to be some religious guy. I didn't want to be a guy always talking about God. And it turned me off. And to this day, I try not to be that guy. I'll let my life live for me. I'll let my life be my testimony. And the blessing of God on my life is evident. It speaks. Anybody that knows me, I believe they can tell, man, that there's something different there. And it's not me. It's the blessing of God on me. But I remember I didn't want to be that guy, so I just kind of didn't want to commit to God. But anyway, when I did, it was like kind of God, me taking this bad situation, what was everything I was experiencing, and what I thought would be the end of my life, what I thought would be like, you know, from now on, you know, my life is going to be boring from now on. You know, it's, I'm going to be this guy just going to church, I guess, that's it, you know, that's, but man, that was the biggest lie, the biggest misconception that I had, probably I've ever had. When I really gave my life to God, man, things turned around. He turned a bad situation, my current situation, what I knew, which was basketball and my friends, and that it was coming to an end, it was coming to a close, and I thought I've got nothing. And I said, you know what, I'm just gonna give. I felt like this drawing to God, and I gave it to him, thinking my life for sure is over. But man, he works all things for good. God gave me a life that I never would have dreamed about. You know, I never would have, you know, many of you watching are my close friends today. And you know, I didn't see that back then. But the reason I have you as my friend today, many of you, is because of
my relationship with God, and somehow God connected those paths. And man, I've the people I have in my life and the purpose I have, you know, I got way more purpose today than I ever had when I thought I was giving it all up. No, I wasn't giving up. I was actually gaining. And this, to me, this point in my life was pivotal, because this was literally the best decision I ever made. 20 years later, if you were to ask me, if you go back, would you change it? No way. No way. I didn't know it as an 17, 18 year old kid what I was doing, but I was literally making the best decision of my life. The friends that I have, my wife, and the ministry, and you know, I got so much going on right now in life. Back then I thought I'm gonna have nothing. Life is gonna be boring, just a blur. And I got so much going on in my life right now, even in the midst of a quarantine or a social distancing. Man, it's still just a lot. Most people, I don't think could do what we're doing had it not been for the grace of God on my life. Because, man, we live life on the go, and it's fun, and it's I mean, there is no letdown. There is no, you know, every day we wake up, it's a, man, we gotta go. There's things to do, and it makes life fun. It makes life adventurous. But this is, for me, the beginning of taking a bad situation, because at the age of 17 or 18, it was bad. In other words, I didn't know. I was dealing with all these thoughts, and I just didn't know how things could ever get better. And I put it into God's hands, and He turned it around. And man, it's for His own good. So I really encourage you, if you're watching, if you just said yes to Jesus, or you've said yes, but you've kind of just been back and forth, a big misconception there is thinking that if you give your life fully to God, that your life is over. Man, I'm not going to be able to hunt or fish or hang out with my friends or have any more fun. You begin to think of what you're going to lose. In reality, what you're missing out is you're not focusing on what you're going to gain. And what He brings to the table is far greater than anything you have right now. Far greater. God brings to the table more than you could ever imagine or think or dream of. And that's what He's done in my life. And the fun part is, the neat part is, He's brought so much to the table, into my life, that He's not done yet. He keeps bringing good. So that's why when you were to ask me, would you ever go back and change it? No way. I'd be the dumbest guy on the planet for me to turn back on God. No, man, He's been super good to me. But He sure does make all things work to good. But I want to show you this, because many of you have heard me mention about my high school days and playing days, but this is it, man. This place here is super, super special to me. And if any of my teammates, old teammates, are playing, you know, I mean, watching right now, man, I just shout out to you guys, and I appreciate you guys so much. And those were some of the best years of our lives, and we did it together. And I love you guys, even though I don't see you very often. I love you guys. I miss you guys. I wish you guys are doing well. I really do. I hope you're you know, we put up banners in that gym. I hope you're putting up banners in life right now, that you're winning in life. Because, you know, we were taught by a great teacher, you know, to work hard, to outwork everybody, to accomplish our goals. And I hope you're doing that. And if you're not, you know, if you've stumbled along the way, you can still change it around. As long as you got breath in you, as long as the sun goes up, and it went up today, and it's going to go up tomorrow again, man. Let's do it, man. Let's put up banners in our lives. And so anyway, this is it. This is a special place in my heart. I'll take you to the next one. All right. Now we find ourselves in McAllen. Many of you probably know where we're at right now once you get, I guess, a better footage, better visual. This is where a lot of the hospitals are at. I'm going to take you another place where that's one of the probably toughest times in my life. This one may have been the toughest, the darkest. I haven't gone through a lot of really, really hard times, but gone through a few. And this is one. And I got a, like I said, hospitals around here. There's a heart doctor there. But over here is probably one of the hardest places any person can find themselves in. And this, my friends, this office here is where mainly kids come when they're fighting for their lives, when diagnosed with cancer. This place here, Vannie Cook, this is where a lot of the kids go. About 15 years ago, my youngest brother, JR, many of you know him, member of our church, was an eighth grader, and he was not feeling normal. And my mom and parents had taken him to a family doctor, and they ran a few tests and didn't really find out what was wrong at the time. They just knew his numbers, his blood counts and stuff like that were off, and of course sent him to a specialist. And I'll never forget being here in an office in there. In fact, there's a doctor, don't know if he's in today, but Dr. Bernini. I haven't seen him in 10 plus years, but really have a lot of respect and appreciation for. But that was the first day we met him, and we were in a room back there. And the doctor said that in so many words, they were pretty sure he had leukemia, cancer of the blood. And we were gonna have to go to the hospital just around the corner, and they were gonna take more samples, do a spinal tab on him, just check his bone marrow, things like that, and to find out exactly if he had it and what type of cancer and what type of leukemia and all that. And anyway, probably the darkest day of my life, of our family's life. Hard, bad day. And it just kind of stuff that rocks your world. You weren't expecting it. And bam, all of a sudden you're faced with a fight. And it's just tough. It takes all I can to right now to not get emotional, because I can't imagine what moms and dads are going through in there right now. In fact, I pray peace. If you would join me, if you would help me, Father, in Jesus' name, pray peace over these moms and dads, and healing over their kids, Father, and just restoration and healing and victory, Father. I pray against death, and I speak life and release life, Father, and victory, Father, in Jesus' name, over every patient and over every family represented, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. And I pray for these doctors, give them wisdom and help them to be the very best they can for the people that they serve. In Jesus' name, amen. Anyway, it was here where we got, they sent us immediately to the hospital just around the corner, and they did more tests there. And that's where we found out, you know, the type of leukemia he had and his survival rates and all kinds of stuff. And it's there that we realized that we were in a fight. We were fighting for my younger brother's life. In fact, we had, in another meeting in that other hospital, they brought me, my parents, my other brothers in an office, and JR was across the hallway. He was in a bed. They had just done the spinal tab and taken that out. And he thought he was going to leave the hospital immediately. Little did he know that he'd be in there for at least, I think it was about another 3-4 days after that. But it was in there that they told us the news and so on and so forth, and immediately, you know, my heart turning to God. I'm floored, but just like, Lord, you know, we need you. And remember, we started the day off talking about God turning bad situations into good. You think, what good can come out of this? Well, that's the thing. It's hard to visualize and understand when you're in the midst of a battle. When you're in the storm, it's hard to see the sunlight. It's hard to see the end. But you just got to put one foot forward and let it be a step of faith. Just keep walking this thing out in faith. So anyway, I remember doctor telling us what it would be like and so on and so forth, and what would take place in Jared's life. And you say, what good can come out of that? A lot of good things came out of it, a lot. For me personally, Jared was and still is, you know, he's my kid brother. I still call him baby brother, even though he's almost 30 years old. You know, to see your little brother go through that, you know, when he was a kid, when we were kids, you know, you're not going to let anybody hurt him. you know, you'll stand up for him, you know, take care of your younger brothers. But when it's an enemy that you can't see, that you can't physically touch, that you can't physically beat, it's a little bit different. And I did what I knew to do, is, and that's go to God, go to the Word, and fight. And I knew that God didn't do this. I knew God wasn't putting us through this. I knew this was a fight that came to us. And we couldn't sit back and wait this thing out and hope for the best. We had to go at it and fight it. You know, we're not going to sit back, and we're going to do all we know to do. And I remember, being in a different hospital, Renaissance Hospital in Edinburgh, and Jared was in there. They were doing some type of treatment, and it was tough that day. It was just emotionally, things had been, I guess, tough for that time. And I was walking out. I was going, leaving the hospital. I had already been with them for a while, and I had a tear running down my eye. And I sucked. You know, there's my kid brother in there, and not a good day, so to speak. And it's hard leaving him, hard seeing him go through that, hard seeing my parents have to see their child. I mean, it's tough, not good. And a tear running down my eye, and I'm walking out, and the God of the universe speaks to me, you know, that day. So I'm walking out, I heard this in my heart, heard it in my spirit. And so it's God saying, you know, the devil's gonna regret the day he ever did this to you and to your family. And if you know scripture, you know, there's a scripture that says that had the devil known what he was doing to Jesus, he would have never crucified the Lord of glory. In other words, he never would have put Jesus on that cross, because in putting Jesus on the cross, he literally nailed his own defeat, his own future. That was the plan of God and the will of God. And the cross was literally our victory when Satan thought it was his victory. It was his win. But it wasn't. So there I am walking down this hospital, this hallway, and I hear God speak that to me. That had the devil known the end result, what's going to happen in your family's life and your brother, he never would have done this. And man, it encouraged me, it strengthened me. I just needed that boost that day. And it was around that same time that God showed me, he says, you're gonna find out how strong you are. You know, that's something that we would tell God, you know, God, you're all powerful, you're nothing, you know, you can do, there's nothing impossible for you, you're all great, you're all glory, so on and so forth. And when God tells you, you're gonna find out how strong you are. Man, that didn't go to my heart, it went to my head. And I realized, God telling me, you're stronger than you think, you're stronger than you know. So that's why today, whenever I go through something, I've faced bigger giants. You know, everything that we got going on in the church, in the school, in our outreaches, in life, and business, everything we got going on, man, we face challenges. My wife and I, our ministry, we face challenges all the time. But we got this thing, this saying, you know, it's gonna work out. And it goes back to Romans 8:28, all things work out together for good to those that love God and are called according to his purpose. That's our fallback. It's gonna be good. And we're not just trying to be positive. We know the end result. I mean, God's never failed us. So we always say, it's gonna work out, it's gonna work out, it's gonna work out, because most of the giants that I face today, if I could even, I don't even wanna call them giants, most of those challenges that we face today pale in comparison to these type of giants. And if these giants fell, if I won those battles in the name of Jesus and through his grace and through his power, his faithfulness, his word, why am I gonna get rattled when I'm facing a little storm, when I'm facing a little rain, a little challenge, I've seen bigger giants go down. And it was in there, in that battle, that God told me, you know, you're gonna find out, Jaime, how strong you are. All these years of putting the word in my heart, all these years of building faith, the day the battle came to me, I had the faith and I had the strength to fight it. Now, I'm not saying I won it, I didn't win it. Well, I'm not taking God away, glory from God. God gets all the glory, but you got to understand, David had to fight the giant. God was there, but it wasn't until his man chose to take the fight to the giant, that the victory for God's people became reality. And so in life, when you're facing stuff, you know, you can say, God, 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 and God's there in the midst, but God's saying, pick up your sword, fight. You're bigger than that. You got me inside of you. We can do this. We can win, but I need you to fight. So like right now with things, what's happening right now, and that's why, you know, we're not going to wait it out. Go out there and fight. Go out there, pray a victory over this coronavirus and an end to it. And don't succumb to fear. Use your faith. And that's one of the things that I took away out of that, that when God spoke that to me all those years ago, you know, all my family was praying. Our church family was praying. So it was everybody's faith. But I remember God wasn't impressed with or intimidated with the giant, with leukemia. For God, it was like, you're greater. The one inside of you is greater. My word in you is greater. Tommy Birchfield, Pastor Tommy, used to always, still says, put the word in you when you don't need it, so it'll be there when you do. In other words, what he's saying is, put the word in you so faith will be strong, so that when you do find it yourself in a challenge, faith is ready to fight and overcome that challenge, as opposed to not having the word in you and not having faith in you, and now all of a sudden you have a challenge and you get rattled. No. That's why David was looked at that giant, and his faith, his perspective was, I don't care if he's 10 foot tall, my God's bigger. Got that out of it, out of that whole bad situation. And the other thing I remember clearly was, I remember the first night that we were in that hospital and we took communion. Jared was in a hospital bed, and we took communion, and I believe God had told me to tell our family, you know, we're going to get through this and he's going to get us a victory. But, you know, don't forget when we get to the other side, who did this? You know, we were declaring victory before we ever saw victory. But when we do get to the victory side, don't forget. Don't forget who we called out to. And I told my parents and I told people in that room, I said, we're going to get on the other side, but don't forget God when things are good again. And I'll never forget, like, it was maybe a week after that, 2 weeks after that, you know, my mom and dad walk into church, and 15 years ago, and they cried out to God and for their child's life. Their son was fighting for his life. We were all fighting for his life. And I'm sure in there, they had their conversations with God. And before they saw victory, they got themselves in the church and plugged in the church. And it's been 15 years. And when they got the victory, when all the reports changed and everything looked good and great and better than it ever was before, did they ever stop going to the church? I said it a couple weeks ago, that some of our most faithful people, they're there every Sunday. And in fact, my dad, you know, gives me advice about the church, and I know it encourages him watching me preach. And this is way before I ever was a pastor of our church. They were there. So they're not going to our church because their son's a pastor. They're going to their church, that church, because 15 years ago they called out to God. They called out to God, and God heard their call, their cry, and honored it and saved them and saved their child's life. And they haven't forgotten. And so when this is all over, when we go back to quote-unquote normal, many of you have called out to God and God's going to protect you. You didn't get the virus and you kept your job, or God got you something better. Don't forget. It's very important. Too many times we forget how good he is and how faithful he is. And we turn our back. We literally turn our back. Right now we pray every day. We're God, please help. And then things get good again, and we kind of look the other way. It's not right. It's not right. Bible says that your faith is like gold. It doesn't become purified and really, really strong until it gets tested. You know, faith, gold gets tested by fire, and our faith gets tested by fire. When it's in these challenges that our faith is just, it gets strengthened. And once you get over and past the challenge, then the next one, you're that much stronger. So that's why I say, whenever we face challenge, I don't want to call them giants, but whenever we face challenges, we face bigger. And God's got us through it. We got the victory, and this one will be just the same. That's why David had that attitude. I beat the lion, I beat the bear, and this giant will be just like them. So This is probably the hardest one in my life. And I'm so glad those days are over, way past us. It's been years, 15 years. And Jair's healed and whole and healthy. And our family, I mean, all this did was really give us a platform to give other people hope. And I do pray for people that are in that situation, because I can identify with those parents and those kids. Been there, done that. Never plan on going back again. But anyway, God works all things to our good. Again, God didn't do this. The fight came to us, but God said, you know what? We'll get through it. And at the end of it, you're going to be better. You're going to be stronger because of it. Some good will come out of it. Let me take you to one more place. All right, we're still in the McAllen area. Over here where there's a lot of doctors and stuff like that. Let me take you to another place where signifies a tough time in our lives. And if you go to our church and you've been with us long enough, you've heard me talk about these stories. Hopefully this will help you put a picture to it. I'm gonna have to park across the street because it looks like they're doing work to the building. But this one here was, again, one of those tough times, because that office across the street there used to belong to Dr. Hugo Zapata. And Dr. Zapata is a great man. And this man delivered all four of my babies, all four of my daughters. But before all four of them came to being, many of you know, we had two miscarriages, and that was tough. All our lives, as we were getting older before marriage, you know, she dreamed of having kids, and I dreamed of having kids before Steph and I ever met. We actually even both knew that we would adopt before we even talked to each other. You know, I had, as a high school kid, I thought one day I'm gonna adopt somebody, make a difference in somebody's life. And so anyway, we came together. We were just dreaming together, two young people. I mean, we worked at a school where we had kids. We've always had kids in our lives. We were youth pastors. Always been in kids ministry. And now when it came time for us to grow our family, Steph had, we had two miscarriages, and both of them were tough. Very, very tough emotionally. And in that place is where we meet with the doctor, and the doctor couldn't tell us exactly what was going on. He never really got answers. We just that was a situation that we had at hand. It's another bad time. I remember thinking stuff like, you know, thoughts coming. A lot of times Satan, the enemy, comes and he fights you with thoughts. And here, the lack of peace, like right now, maybe a lot of people are lacking peace. But, and thoughts like, you know, you're going to grow old and you'll never have kids and you'll never have grandkids, that kind of stuff. I mean, just these thoughts bombarding you, and we have to cast, the Bible says, cast those thoughts down. Anyway, I'll never forget one of the meetings that we had in here. Many of you have heard me talk about that one. I felt like the walls were caving in on me, man, and they were going to run tests on Stephanie, try to figure out what's going on. And I didn't want to be in there anymore. I couldn't. I wanted to be there for her, but I just remember looking at her and I said, Steph, do you need me in here? And she just said, no, I'll be all right. And I just want to get away. I want to talk to God. Anyway, walk out. The old academy, the original McAllen Academy here in the valley, was just around the corner. And I was planning on going to academy, and something just hit me on the inside. I said, no, I'm going to go shop for baby clothes. And I was emotional, I was hurting. And there was a Mervyn's or one of those clothing that I don't think they exist anymore, at least not here. I pulled into that. I was supposed to go to Academy. I pulled into that and I walked in, and doors open up, and straight across was a rack of baby clothes. And I went straight to it. Never bought a piece of clothing for a child, much less a little girl. But we knew what we wanted. We wanted a daughter. We wanted our first child to be a daughter. That was our heart's desire. I walked in there and looked across, or that, and there was a denim skirt suit outfit, whatever. Oshkosh was, I think that's pronounced, was the brand, and I looked at it. So this is it, first piece of clothes that I'll buy for my daughter. Keep in mind, I just left this place a couple minutes before, and they're running tests on my wife because they don't know what's happening. We don't have any answers. But faith says, you know, we're gonna have children. Faith goes to the word and what the word says. So anyway, I remember giving it to the cashier, a young lady, and she probably thinking, oh man, this guy's buying clothes for his daughter, for his baby, and not knowing that I just came from a doctor that said, you lost your baby. And the enemy's telling me, you're never gonna have a baby. But it's at that point that it matters what you say. That's what matters most. So I remember buying that and later on picking up Stephanie and just handing it over to her. And of course she's a little emotional and we're emotionally tired, you know, feeling it. And anyway, Ashley was born within that year, 12 months, something like that. Later, we had our first child and Ashley wore that. And 2 or 3 years later, Jamie was born and we kept that outfit and she wore it. 2 or 3 years after that, Amber was born and she wore that same outfit. And then 2 or 3 years after that, Aubrey was born and she wore it. And I joke around, I should have bought some boys' clothes because I pretty much did it with that skirt. I bought a skirt and they all came out girls. Sometimes I wonder if I would have bought a boys, what do we have had a boy? But anyway, I'm super blessed with my daughters. But I mentioned that story because many of you have heard it. And it was tough, but God didn't do that. And I remember one of those times going back to the house. I was parked in front of the front of our house, and we were going to go see our pastors at the time. And I remember just getting Stephanie's hand there in front and just getting super emotional and not understanding why things were happening the way they did. I remember calling out to God and just saying, God, I love you today more than I did yesterday. And God, tomorrow I'm going to love you more than I do today. And I said that because it was a statement of faith, but I also needed to hear it for myself. No matter what happens, I need to realize that it's not God doing this. I'm not trying to convince God to help me. No. I need to. We've got an adversary. God's not the enemy here. God's not bringing this hard time. The one I need to run to and need on my side is Him. And we never really got answers. We never really found out. I just knew to keep putting one foot forward, the step of faith forward. And like I said, we have our kids today. In fact, after our fourth, you know, I was ready to keep going. Let's keep having more kids, Steph. And she was kind of like, no, this is it. Now we're adopting. But it's amazing how after that, I don't know when Stephanie got healed or I don't know what happened, but all of a sudden, you know, she became great pregnancies and great deliveries. But that was God turning things around. We had a situation in our hands. We don't know what the problem was, but we went to Him and He fixed it and He turned it around. And we're super blessed with our kids. And like I said, if we want to have more kids, we can keep going. I mean, I'm that confident. Anyway, this one here, many of you, like I said, have heard that story, but that was the office. That was where I was sitting down. That's where we heard the news. And we came back, and that same doctor that said, don't know what's going on, delivered all four of them. And great doctor. I have tons of respect for that guy and appreciation for him, gratitude. But, you know, God will definitely turn things around. And in the situation that we're in, it's going to turn around. So I took it to three different places where it all started for me in the very beginning, my old stomping grounds. That's where I first saw it, where God, whatever you give up, whatever you put in God's hands, He'll give it back to you and better. I took you to where the hardest point in my life was when we were fighting an invisible enemy, a deadly killer, and we beat it. God turned it around, and we realized how strong we were, and we realized there's nothing in this life we can face that we won't beat. And this one here, our biggest desire to have kids, you know, at a time where it didn't look like we were going to have kids, but we kept trusting and believing. And man, God turned it all around. You ask me, what does our house look like? Our house is full. Our house is lively. You walk into my house, you know, it's just a lot going on. And it's funny, not funny, but it's interesting. There was a time when the enemy was saying, you're not going to have any of that. You can't even look at where we are now. So I'll tell you, maybe the enemy's told you some stuff. Maybe fear is telling you some stuff that you're not going to do this, that you're not going to make it. I'm just here to tell you that that's not the end result. If you're willing to fight, if you're willing to believe God, if you're willing to put it in His hands and follow Him and trust Him, He can turn bad situations into good. In fact, whatever you can dream of, He can do better than that. That's the kind of God we serve. That's how good He is. That's how powerful He is. But it takes faith and it takes walking this thing out. So anyway, let's go ahead and head back to one of my favorite places on the earth. We started there, and that's our church, our what we call the house. Let's go back home for a little bit. All right, so we find ourselves back here where we started. This is what we call the house. I want to read one more time as we get ready to close today. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, those who are called according to His purpose. All things work together for good, those that love God. I know we love God, but remember those three questions that I had this morning. Do you believe in God? I think most of us said yes. Do you believe in His word, that it's true? And I think most of us said yes, and I hope all of us. And then question number three, do you think that when this is all over and we find ourselves on the other side, that we'll be better? And that's the question that I want you to, you know, keep with you and keep answering every day, and believing that when this is done, that we'll be stronger, that we're better, that we're not just going to wait this thing out. We're not just going to survive, but as many people say, we're going to thrive. And, you know, find the good in every situation. You know, for me personally, being at the house, you know, this kind of forced us to be at the house. You know, we were so fast paced before this that I kept telling myself and telling Steph that, hey, man, we need to be able to go more, be at the house more for the girls, so on and so forth. Been trying to do that for a while. And it's forcing us. So again, finding the light in every situation. And so I'm seeing that, I'm getting that time that I needed to be at the house. And we've gotten this thing where we go walking just about every day. We'll take our dog and walk around the neighborhood. We've walked more around our neighborhood this last month than we have in the entire 10 years that we've lived in that neighborhood. Can you imagine that? In 1 month, we've taken way more walks than we ever had in the previous 10 years combined. Spending more time playing games with the girls, because now we have the time. You know, we're always together when we're in our regular routine, but this one, we're at the house and we've got more time, you know, so making the best of it. You know, in this situation, you know, things can be better. You know, you've been wanting to do more with your kids or with your wife, or send more texts, you know, calling loved ones and friends that you hadn't talked to. Hey, you got more time. Send a text, send an email, do something, make a phone call. This can turn out to be something good. I know personally, I've got something in my heart right now that's getting big. It's on the personal side. It's a good side. And I'm seeing vision. And I just last night and today, I was thinking that's going to be another good thing that's going to come out of this whole situation 5 years from now. If what I'm seeing, this personal thing, if it comes to pass and it reaches fruition, it's going to be because those 2 months that we were at the house, I got an idea, and when we got out, I started working on it, and it turned into this. Where it originated from was during this time. That's how, again, an example of God taking a bad situation and turning it out to our good. So for us personally and in the ministry, this is what it's doing, and I hope this is what it'll do for you. This is a reset. We've been used to living life a certain way, and now all of a sudden we've been pulled back, and it's like a reset. Things start over, start new. When we get back in church, are we going to do things the same way? For us, for our ministry, those of you that are ministers that are looking at this right now, hey, this is a reset. It's given you an opportunity to pull back and start over. And what we used to know to be normal, and we've always done it because that's the way we do it, now we got to do things differently,
And going forward, how is it going to it can change things for the better? So I'm excited about it. I really am. It is a reset in different levels in the ministry. In your, it could be for your work and in our family and the way we our time now. You know, we're walking around the neighborhood. Hey, why stop when we go back to normal? We really enjoy walking around the neighborhood. Let's not stop when we get back to quote unquote normal. Let the reset. Let good things come out of this reset. So I'm super excited. That's why I've been saying I'm not going to wait this thing out and just sit down and hope this is over sooner rather than later. No, in the middle of it, I'm going to learn. I'm going to grow. I'm going to get stronger. And when the gates are open, man, I'm going to have a head start and I'm going to be doing more, being more effective because of this reset. So God can turn all things into good. Find out what your reset is. Find out where you need to grow, where you need to learn. Open your eyes to see how you can be better. I can't do that for you. You can. You're the only one that can do that. Ask God to show you what the reset is. And then go to Romans 8:28. God works all things for your good so that we can all say when this is all said and done, yeah, that coronavirus stuff, when it hit, it's over now, but it caused us to look at life differently and make some adjustments that now we're not going to go back to the way we were doing it. We like the adjustments that we made in our business, in our marriages, in our ministry, in our relationships. It caused us to relook things over, make adjustments, and we're better today. And you can have a testimony. After the test, you've got that testimony. So I shared some things personally that were really, really hard. Those were tough challenges. And they're in the past now. But coming out of them, man, we're so much stronger. I'm so much stronger. So anyway, we win. Praise God. We'll keep on moving forward. Keep tuning in. Remember, I'm going to ask that you share this. I'm going to ask that you like it. Follow us on Instagram, on Facebook, on our YouTube channel. Just do us a favor and do yourself a favor and send it out there so we can reach more people. The Bible said, freely we receive, freely we give. All of this is free. What the best thing you can do is give hope and give help be give faith to others. So anyway, love you very much. But before I go, if you're listening and you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you've never said yes to him, I want to give you an opportunity real quick, really, really quick. Do this. Repeat after me. Say this. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I come to you today. I receive you as my Lord and as my Savior. Forgive me of all sin. Accept me as your son today, Father. I believe in Jesus. I believe that he died on the cross. I believe that he rose from the dead. And today he's alive. And I declare him as my Lord and as my Savior. Just repeat that after me. If you need to go back and pray that again, but pray it to the Father. And do me a favor, if you said that, if you prayed that, or you came back to God, send me a message through Facebook or however you can. Send me an email. Reach out to us. I just want to hear about that. I don't want anything from you. I really don't. I just want to rejoice with you and congratulate you. And I just want to know that somebody said yes to Jesus. That to me is one of the greatest things I ever experienced, is when somebody gets to know God, because the day I met him changed my entire life for the better. Hey, I love you. We'll see you very, very soon. Stay plugged in. Love you. God bless you. And we win. We're coming out stronger. Thank you.
shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
He is with you in the morning. is true. Your word is true. Come on, some of you have been having a hard time really holding on to the truths of the Word of God. You've been fearful. You've been questioning. But God, is this really true? Is this really true? And I want to remind you today, yes, it is. And His Word says that everything that He says that He will do, it cannot return void. That it must do what it has set out to do. So we just speak life over you and the promises of God. Just receive them. Just speak it out. Even right now, just say, God, I trust you again. I believe in your promises over my life. I take hold of your promises again and again and again and again. And we tell our souls and our spirit man to line up with the Word of God, to be at peace, to receive the truth of who He is, who He is, Jesus.
Hey church, so many of you may be wondering how you can continue to give and to give your tithe during this time when we're not able to meet together in one building. And I just want to remind you that we have a give button on our app that you can download our app, World Harvest Family Church. Just look it up on your app store, click the give button, follow the instructions. You can also text to give. You text WHFC to 77977. And then follow the directions, the instructions they'll give you. We have a button on our website on whtcministries.org that you can click there to give. And you can mail it in, good old snail mail, in the envelope and just mark it on there what it's for. But either way, go ahead and you can do that. Give us a call if you have any trouble or questions.